Okay, welcome everybody. Thank you for coming. It's a pleasure for me to introduce Dr. Giannakis from the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering at the University of Minnesota, who's also the director of the Digital Technology Center. It was called Digital Media, no? Okay, I think it actually needs no introduction, as you all probably know that. He got his diploma of an engineer from the Technical University of Athens in 81, and then in 82, respectively, in 86, he got his MS and PhD, I'm sorry, in 86, right, PhD in electrical engineering. He's got so many degrees, I can't even keep track. And a master's degree in mathematics. And he's been at Minnesota since 1999, where he's the ADC chair in wireless communication professor. And his interests span many different dimensions. And in fact, so much so that now we're actually studying him in my group. We're studying his network of publications. He's extremely widely published. He has over 300 journal papers, over 500 conference papers. He has an H index of 98, for those of you who know what the Hurst index is. And his research basically spans many, many different themes, including compressive sensing, cognitive radio, wireless networks, many, many different things. And he's got a lot of distinguishing awards, like the Marconi Prize Award in Communication. And he's a fellow, of course, fellow many years of IEEE, as well as IRSEP. And he also got the Taylor Award for Distinguished Researcher from the University of Minnesota. And he's also been a distinguished lecturer of the SP Society, the IEEE SP Society. And it's a pleasure to have him here and to talk to us about some of his recent work in social analysis, social data analysis, and social networks. And it's a pleasure to have you. Thank you. The floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Hamid. Through the years, I have the pleasure of interacting with many accomplished people. Hamid is one of them. And last time I came here, I talked to you about sensor networks, something like 4 years ago, we figured. My expertise has spanned the areas of statistical signal processing, my interests, I should say, wireless comms, networking. And these days, I do things that sort of blend all three and in new fields, like I like to work on. Social data analysis and power and renewables, optimization and monitoring issues, and a number of related subjects. So today, on the toolbox side, I want to establish that controlling sparsity is tantamount to affecting robustness. So I will try to draw a link between two well-established areas, that of robust statistics and that of sparsity, modern notion. The motivation is simple. Jenkins, a statistician, said that all models are wrong, basically, except for a few that are maybe useful. And the idea is this, that if you take a model that you like and you try to fit it to the data, a good model will give rise to a few outliers. So my basic key idea is that if the outlier sequence is sparse, then I'm doing pretty well on robustness. And that's basically the theme, the take-home message of this talk. And credit where is due, this is due to my PhD student, Gonzalo Mateos. who in his last part of his PhD looked at problem related to this thing. Here is the motivation. I'm going to give it a spin of learning. And, you know, this gentleman, actually Quickier, he published an article in The Economist, and says basically that there are a lot of data available. What is scarce is the ability to extract wisdom from them. All right. And the data are indeed big. They're fast. If you watch the stock market, you need online algorithms. They're ubiquitous in the sense this is a snapshot on a day of people that uploaded something on Flickr throughout the US. They can be revealing, actually, some people, when the Oakland police published things, they figured out tactics of the police. And the data can be productive, we can do clever things with those, but also they tend to be what? Messy. And the messy is with a Y, you know, for on purpose, right? And this is what
you have done in European culture or South American.
Yeah, cultures. Soccer as well. Yeah, educated. Actually, here there is a word messy. Doesn't show very well, but it's a why. And this is to allude to the fact that there are data that are bad. They're contaminated. There are outliers in the data. Okay. So, what is the social context here? Is the interaction between people and computers? And the vision is to sort of identify the preferences or measure the preferences of people. There's a huge field in economics that is called preference measurement in business and marketing. Analyze them and control so that you can understand and engineer what NSF calls SOCs, or systems, or I'm sorry, social computational systems. And that's the context that this work fits. Our vision, our means, is to leverage the dual role of sparsity, as I said. So sparsity is leveraged in two ways. The first one is known. Where you know that nature is parsimonious, tends to be parsimonious, and engineering systems better be parsimonious or simple enough to be controlled. So that has given rise to the effort toward exploiting sparsity of signals of interest. What people have not realized, and this is a novel thing of this work, is that you can exploit sparsity even for signals that are not sparse, if you look at sparse, if you look at the residuals. And that is what will endow us with robustness. So sparsity has two important features. It controls or reduces complexity of the model and can affect robustness. All right. Let me start with a problem, and I will walk you through some simple ideas. I'll try to find the simplest possible way. I'm going to talk about parametric methods, non-parametric methods for estimation, as well as a little bit of classification, as well as dimensionality reduction type of things with robustness. Now, back in 78, this gentleman coined the term conjoint analysis, which in our terms means that you want to optimally design and position new products, say, for example, iPhone 5 versus Samsung Galaxy S3. And the idea is to describe products by a set of attributes or parts. Think of a vector of features, right? The goal is to learn the consumer's utility function from this preference data. I will formulate it mathematically so you will see it clearly what I'm talking about. And if you assume that the utility is linear function of your attributes, then basically you want to see how much is each part is worth. So, for example, Hamid is a user. Does he like in his cell phone the audio part, the visual part, the resolution, the screen size, what have you? This every part and feature of the phone has a value for him, right? And the success story came in 89 when Marriott put forward this Courtyard chain, and they went out. They defined as attributes like the room size, TV options, restaurant, transportation to the airport, satellite TV, what have you, in a big vector. And they questioned people, which one do you like, rank, right? Do you like this configuration? They start changing the attribute. Big size TV, you know, small bed, balcony, what have you. That's one feature. Then they show them, do you like this versus this versus this, right? And then based on responses, they were trying to figure out what people like the most, right? And that's how they came up with this preference measurements. Now let's try to formulate it a little bit mathematically. Suppose I have I responders, that's my index for responders, and every profile is a row, Xij transpose of profiles. And J is the attribute index, different for every user perhaps, and it has P attributes. So I want to estimate the value of part words and what are my data. They can be of different types. They can be YJ, where I present to you different profiles, and you give me a score, all right? YIJ. So, and then you tell me, because sometimes people don't like to score things on an absolute scale, you show them two, and you tell them you like this or that, right? And this is choice-based conjoined data. This is the sine function of the difference between two feature vectors. All right? That gets you closer to classification if your answer is plus minus one, right? So online social-based preference data are abundant through the internet, and many times they contain inconsistent, corrupted, or even irrelevant data. Some people score at random, right, or they don't care about. So this is the source of the outliers. So my goal is to robustify, yes, but please feel free to interrupt. I forgot to say that.
What's W?
W is the part worth, is a vector. So for example, let's say in an if you normalize the norm to be one, then you can say that Hamid likes 0.1%, 10% the room size, 20% bigger screen TV, and so that's what exactly I want to find out about you, right? So it's a regression problem or a classification problem, right, with a social context, if you like. Of course, there are other issues that I don't touch upon today. Another important issue is how do you decide the profiles? And can you do that online, depending on the answer that he gave, change the profile? It's an experimental design problem, right? And that's a very important one to carry out online. Suppose that you score something online, then what's the next question I want to ask you? That's the profile. But here I'm assuming I have a set of questions or profiles. But let me go now to have you think in terms of regression, right? Yes.
Let me guess that because the data is sort of messy, you have here a lot more of these equations than variables, right?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I have here, typically if I drop the J component or the I component, I can drop the I component, assuming that I want to target, let's say, undergraduate students, and I put these questions to undergraduate students. So I assume that my population is homogeneous. If I want to mix and match things, I can put a different index profile, but I can perceive that I'm measuring same realizations of the same user, basically, the student user, all right? So, but for now, let's look at, I want to solve this regression problem, let's say, the first one is the simplest, and I want to solve it in a robust manner. If you go look into the statistics tools, one of seemingly very simple problem that all of us should know, but it's not as well known, is what statisticians call least trim squares. Let me tell you what that is. Suppose you drop the index I, you have homogeneous population, you get many YJs. So many YJs, you know XJs, you want to find W. So these RJs are the residuals, okay? Suppose someone tells you that, you know what, out of the 1,000, you know, people that you questioned, students that you questioned, about 10% of them or 20% of them are not reliable. So I want you to find the least squares solution for the 80% of the students. So what you do is you look at the residuals and you trim the residuals that are the highest. You keep only the new residuals, all right? And then you minimize that. So RJ with brackets is the order statistic among all these residuals. So J minus mu is discarded. Okay, surprise, surprise, the simple least squares problem is NP-hard to solve. The least squares is available in closed form. If I tell you, you know, retain only those and solve it, it's NP-hard. But is there any hope? Can you minimize these least trim squares? Sure. You try J choose N residuals, subsets of size N. Every time you solve, you find a closed form. So you have at least one best solution in the least square sense. Right? So it is solvable, but it's NP-hard. And it's very meaningful, right? If I tell you, you know, I know that many are wrong. So it's simple, but intractable beyond small problems. People have come up with optimal solvers, and these guys, Fischler and Bowles in computer vision, have made a lot of money out of this outlier rejection algorithm that they call RANSAC, if some of you have heard about it. It solves that problem by randomly sampling the population. Random sampling and consensus are the initials of RANSAC. I don't want to go into the details of it because I have a better formulation than them, I think. So what I say is this. I have outliers. Okay, outlier variables O. And let us suppose that I have OJ, which is either zero if the jth measurement is not an outlier, or it's non-zero but unknown if YJ contains an outlier. So the problem I face is, given YJ, find W and find OJ. Find the outliers. Very naive, but I'll argue that later on that it's very good. So other people tried to put this model forward, but they didn't make the observations we did. Among those, I want to mention Fuchs in 99, using the epsilon contamination approach of Huber. But what we observed is the following. Both W and the outlier vector O are unknown. And what I want you to notice is that in addition to the W that you have every time that the datum becomes available, you also have an OJ coming adding up. So you can never catch up. So you always have more unknowns than equations. All right? So the problem is severely underdetermined. What saves us is, hopefully, the fact that O is typically sparse. You don't have too many outliers. So there is a hope there, right, if it is sparse. Now that we recognize this, our way of formulating the problem as an optimization problem was like this. Okay, you like the least squares fit. You can have other options. You know, I don't want to complicate matters. So, but you have the least squares fit. And then you put the zero norm, which basically equals the number of non-zero entries, right? The non-zero norm. And you say it's less than tau. So if we can solve that problem, then we can solve the other one. So if I write this in Lagrangian form, I can tune the parameter lambda zero to control the sparsity in O. Okay? Now, that is the number of outliers. Clearly, if I put lambda zero to be very large, this thing dominates the cost, and the optimum drives it to zero. Right. So I'm getting the least square solution. Then, what we have proved, and it's not too difficult to prove, is the following. If you can solve this P0 problem, and you choose lambda zero so that the zero norm is J minus nu, then the solution that we find is the same as the least trim squares. So this is beautiful. Why? Because, first of all, it justifies the preference model that I have, because you could have argued, you know what, who told you that outliers can be modeled as additive? Right? Could be anything. But here I prove to you that the most meaningful least trim squares approach is equivalent to this. And it makes a very beautiful connection between sparsity in the residuals, meaning this, and robust estimation. So here W does not have to be sparse, but the residuals have to be sparse. And it's reasonably so. What do you do? The problem is that P0 is NP-hard. That's the only problem here, that this is also NP-hard, as it was the original one. But I can relax it and replace the usual trick, the zero norm of the outliers with the one norm. This is a convex problem. It can be solved efficiently. And, of course, the sparsity controlling role of lambda 1 is central. However, the question that you want to ask is, okay, the P0 affects robustness. How about the P1? Does problem 1 renders yields robust? The most beautiful, one of the beautiful parts of our paper is that to prove, again, to Liner, that the Huber estimates are a special case. So there exists a lambda for which the estimates we obtain by solving this optimization problem is the same as what Huber asserted in robust statistics. And for those of you that have not heard what Huber said, or you have not seen, Huber's idea is very simple. He said, okay, the least squares has a parabola here, right? But I would love, if this is my criterion versus the error, right? I would love to have the least squares being tapered off after a certain point, because the moment I have large errors, that's an indication of an outlier and I want to suppress it, right? But anything that you do, and there are many robust costs, rho, that you can devise, they tend to be non-convex. So, for example, if you do something like this, you send the error to zero outside, then that's a non-convex cost. The closest thing that is convex is to take the tangent at the parabola and make it a line. All right? And if you make it a line, Huber proved that this is minimax optimal, meaning that among all the distributions that would have generated the contamination of your original model, the least favorable of it, you minimize, yields the maximum variance of the estimator, and by choosing the least favorable, you minimize the least favorable distribution. And that is Huber. And what we have shown is that Huber's is a special case. In fact, we have argued that you should not go the Huber way. You should select the lambda in a way that is driven by the data, because Huber works if the epsilon contaminated model, for example, holds true. Otherwise, it does not. So what is our idea? Is to lasso the outliers. So basically, we minimize problem P1 and in an alternating fashion So if you fix, if you have an estimate of W, you minimize over O, and you can find it in a lasso form using soft thresholding by solving this problem. And if O is given, then the good old squares applied to the outlier compensated data yields W. Okay? So we alternate between the two. And basically, we have systematic ways to select lambda 1. And if you tell me, you need to know one of two things to select judiciously lambda 1. Either you need to know the percentage of outliers, or you need to know the variance of the nominal noise, like without outliers in your active model, what do you have? So, of course, in addition to the L1 regularization, you can come up with non-convex regularizations, and these that we have seen to be very effective are those that approximate the L0 norm better. I guess you understand what I'm talking about, right? If you want to plot the zero norm, right, of the outliers, this is the zero norm, right, versus O. The zero norm, if you have a scalar value, is 1 if the value is non-zero, and then it takes a dip and goes like this, right? That's a zero norm plotted in a scalar case. If you look at the L1 norm, it approximates this thing by this. That's the L1 norm, right? And better alternatives emerge if you pursue something like a logarithm. A logarithm does something like this, right? But you can imagine this creature here is non-convex, right?
You have to put things exactly in the right place.
The eraser.
The eraser. You have to put it exactly in its place.
In the tray.
Right. Now you can write.
Got it. Thank you. So if you use this, this is a non-convex function, right? So you like to do that whenever you are very close to the optimum. That's why you want to use the lasso at the very beginning until you go close to the optimum, and then switch over to non-convex regularizations where you are close to the optimum. All right, so how does this thing looks like? It looks like the weighted L1 norm. It's like if you add the logarithm and you linearize it around the current estimate, then this boils down to a weighted L1 norm depending on the iteration. And it turns out that this has the effect of yielding unbiased estimates. So it improves the estimates considerably.
So you're talking a problem where you have signal, you have noise that has low amplitude, and you have a few outliers that are big amplitude. Now, what if your noise would become, instead of low amplitude, medium amplitude? Would this still work, or would it collapse?
It works. Okay. Not only that, but this one will work. It works meaning what? It has a performance that is governed by, you're not going to do better than your least squares with that level of the noise. So the SNR will deteriorate your performance, clearly. But what I'm trying to say, I wanted to add to, I forgot what I wanted to say now. It will come to me as we go. I wanted to make another point, but what did I want? You said about, say it again.
Okay, what I was saying is that this is signal plus low amplitude noise plus outliers, and now I'm saying instead of low amplitude noise.
Yeah, now I remember. Yeah, this will work even in cases that look like this. Suppose that you have, here we say YJ, right? Suppose that for some J's, you have what I said, XJ transpose W plus noise, and for some J's, and for some other J's, you may have OJ for J equals up to J1 and then J1 plus 1 up to J2. So even if I throw away complete outliers, that will work again. Of course, the performance will depend on SNR, but there's nothing that prevents it from fundamentally working. Now, comparison with RANSAC, quite impressive on the synthetic side. So this is what we did. We have W drawn from a normal distribution, and this is a normal, the nominal model, which is least squares, Gaussian. And outliers were drawn from Laplacian and were inserted at points 0, 10, up to 80. And then what I'm plotting here is root mean square error of the W versus the percentage of outliers. And if you do RANSAC, random sampling and consensus, depending on how many draws you have, 1,000 draws or 10,000 draws, you may go do well up to 30% outliers or up to 40, 50% outliers. But the amazing part is that we can afford as much as 80% outliers and be stable with this L1 convex followed by concave refinements. So this is basically the mean and the variance, shown here with the blue. And both our mean as well as our variance is very, very robust, yeah.
80% outliers?
Yeah.
Wouldn't that be deciding that what's the outlier is the main
but
noise?
That's the trick. You throw away the outliers. You identify and throw them away. That's the whole trick. You rely your estimate on the clean ones. That's the... But the issue is, can you identify them? That's the issue. And that's where we do extremely well, because you can get the support very well, you see? This is the nice thing about the L1 norm. We can say which one looks wrong. All right. Now that we understood that it does well with parametric regression problems, you can say, ask yourself questions like, how about interactions among attributes, right? Why should I believe in the linear relationship? So if you don't trust the model, if the moment you trust more the data than the model, then you typically go non-parametric regression. This is the pioneer work of Waba. This lady formulated a problem like yj is a function of xj, and then you request u to live in a space of, for example, smooth functions. It could be unlimited. It could be other properties of those functions. But Tikhonov and Waba formulated the problem in a reproducing kernel Hilbert space, and they defined a kernel K that induces a norm in that space. So basically, instead of solving the previous problem, all right, we solve the problem like this. So you minimize now, it's a variational problem, you minimize over a space of functions. And you add outliers, which you ask them to be sparse again, but now you confine the functions to live in the Hilbert space. In this particular case, if you say H is a Sobolev space, which means your second Hessian is bounded, so you know that, right? It's kind of, it's like requiring second derivative of u of x dx to be bounded. So these functions that satisfy that. Then if you solve this problem, surprisingly, and you use what machine learning people call the representer's theorem, you can prove that this function is expressible in terms of kernels, which in this particular case happens to be the B-splines. Okay, we are signal processing guys, so we got to know Nyquist theorem. If the set of functions belongs, is bound-limited, contains the bound-limited functions, then this guy will assert that the optimum estimator is the reconstruction based on sync functions. All right? So it will tell you, take your functions, take your kernels, and have them sit on, oh, take your kernels. So the best estimate so the best estimate that minimizes that problem will be some coefficients Cj, sinc functions of x minus xj. These functions solve this optimization problem. And if you don't have the L1 norm, if you have the L1 norm, it will induce sparsity in those. All right? So we use that to, and this is a true function, it would look like this. This is a non-robust prediction if you have outliers, and this is a robust prediction of it, and this is a refined prediction with the non-concave regularization. We took some real data from the power utility companies in Minnesota. There you have the load curve, which is electric power consumption recorded periodically. So you have reliable data, and sometimes they're contaminated. And here is my student, Gonzalo Mateos, is from Uruguay, soccer fan as well. So he looked at the Uruguay power consumption in milliwatts versus time of the day. And then this is when the Final Four Uruguay game against Holland started. So everybody was watching. It came down. And you go halftime. They go to have a beer or whatever. And then they watch the game, and then it goes back to normal. So it was the time that Uruguay had the best performance in the World Cup in South Africa. But then, that's the game starts, game ends, and halftime. But then we inserted outliers in the energy consumption over time. There is obviously some cyclostationarity that you can witness there. And then these outliers were correctly detected. This is the energy consumption in a government building we got from Minnesota from 2005 to 2010. We fit spline estimators over this 470 hours of operation, and we could identify clearly the outliers that was due to either strikes or building operational transitions, and we cross-verified them correctly. So now I want to switch gears in my last topic and try to talk to you about robustifying the workhorse of dimensionality reduction, which is principal components. All right? So let's recap for a second. What I told you basically from a toolbox perspective is that the well-known things that you understand in regression, linear regression, and also classification, if you have data that go plus minus one, can be robustified by adding an outlier variable and asking it to be sparse. That's what I told you. That connects sparsity control with robustness. And not only I established that for parametric models, but I went on to argue that this is also true over functional spaces, right? Non-parametric regression as well. Not only regression, but also non-parametric regression. Now, let me go into principal component analysis. And in many times, you have to learn from high-dimensional data. Microarray DNA matrix is shown on the left, million by million oftentimes. Traffic surveillance is another application where principal component analysis has been used throughout the years. So you can extract low-dimensional data structure. It's a workhorse if you are a signal image processing guy for data compression and reconstruction. The first step in source coding is you do principal components or Kahur and Loew, and then you do reverse water filling. That's what an information theorist on source coding will tell you. So that's the first step. So we want to robustify PCA again to outliers by controlling the outlier sparsity. And there are people that have used social computational systems, you know, have used PCA in social computational systems for anomaly detection, for video surveillance. I will talk about it in detail. And most recently, for what people call matrix completion for collaborative filtering, recommender systems. You've heard when you go to Netflix to choose a movie, they tell you you may like this, this, and that as well, right? That's the context we have here. Typically, what you do, just to define the problem, in the rows of a matrix, you have people, right? Evaluators. And in the column of the matrix, you have movies, right? And then the entry of each entry corresponds to a score from 1 to 5, how much you like this movie. And because not all people have watched all movies, this matrix has holes. There's missing entries, right? So the goal is to utilize what your collaborators, friends, and similar quotes people with you, what they have watched, to recommend what you would like to watch as well. That's the bottom line of recommender systems, right? So we want to robustify PCA, and there have been people in computer vision that looked at similar problems in the past, and more recently, low-rank matrix recovery from sparse vectors by John Wright, Ma, and Candes. I'll tell you what are the differences later on. Here is, for those of you that have not heard principal component analysis, there are at least three different ways to introduce to someone principal component analysis. And I'll give you a flavor of all three. And the most relevant is the third one. If you are a person that does source coding or compression, then you like this viewpoint. So you start from some training data, some images, you find the sample correlation. You can make an image like a vector, right? So then you are saying that I'm going to use a compression operator, meaning a matrix in this case, which is fat, because it takes a long vector and compresses it to a smaller vector. And then it's a fat, and then I will send it over the channel, and then at the receiver end, I'm going to use a tall matrix, a reconstruction matrix, C. And what I want is the difference between what I transmitted, YI, and the B followed by C, compressed version of YI, is as close as possible. Okay? You understand that this CB, because it's tall times fat, is rank deficient. So I want to approximate a vector by a low rank version of it. And I demand for uniqueness this operator to be unitary. This is, if you solve this problem, you get the principal components. That's the source coding viewpoint. If you ask a person in machine learning pattern recognition, he will tell you, no, you know, here is principal components. Find what directions in the sample covariance, or multiply your vector, the YI, by another vector C, and tell me for what C the resultant inner product has maximum variance. Something maximum variance is maximizing the information. So that component is principal, right? And that's what the pattern recognition guy is going to tell you. So if you ask a guy who does psychometrics and stuff, he may know this model that not many engineers know. And I discovered it recently that is equivalent. So this is called component analysis model. So it tells you, let's postulate a model for each vector yi that is a product between a C, which is tall, and wi. Doesn't it remind you the Partworth thing that I was talking at the beginning? What's the difference? If you minimize this, but you minimize now over C and W, then the result will be identical to these other two interpretations. So in a way, principal component analysis can be thought of as a blind linear regression problem, where you don't know your regressors, right? So believe me that solution to all these three formulations is the same. You take the optimum solution, says Calhoun and Loeb, if you want to keep only Q components, then consider the eigen decomposition of the sample covariance matrix, select the Q eigenvectors corresponding to the largest eigenvalues, Q largest eigenvalues, and do the transpose of it, the transpose of it at the receiver side. And that will yield the principal component vector. Okay? Now, what do you observe here? You have least squares. Likewise, you have maximum a quadratic form, and then again, a least squares form. So it's not too difficult to tell you that principal components, pretty much like least squares, is not robust as a cost function. It's not robust as a criterion. So now that you have seen all these things, you can see what is our trick. Our trick will be, we'll look at the last one, and now M is for the mean, because it's non-trivial to estimate whenever you have robust statistics the mean. So you can have like a blind preference model, and you have the, you normalize it with the OI, and you solve now for O, C, and W. All right, this is something that's coming, just came out in the transactions, the robust PCA. And you can solve it, I don't want you to go into the details, but you can solve it, again, using alternating minimization with guarantees that you converge to a stationary point. So what is the idea here? The idea is that if I don't know M, C, W, and O, that if I know C, W, and O, then the M is easy. You just do, you compensate, they take the Y minus everything, and the finding the mean is like a sample mean of outlier compensated data. If you know M and you know, let's say, what? You know the O from the previous iteration, the outlier, then you substitute it. You use the Y minus M minus O that you know, and now the problem boils down to a PCA problem. And once you have a W and C, then you do soft thresholding like Lasso, and you solve for O. So that's the basic idea. Now, this is a video, real data, from these guys at CMU. This is the original PCA. So what you see here are three scenes. We have a video. I can don't want to play it, so I took a snapshot of three. Now, what the PCA isolates, so you put images, again, into a matrix, do PCA, and when you retain 10 components, which are the principal components, you get the background. Okay? And when you do, if you look at this one, for example, you get some ghosts. So the outliers here are the people. So this is surveillance video, right? You want to identify people in a video. But you see here, the PCA has some ghosts, and if you do robust PCA, it's fairly clean as when you compare the two. And if you want to see the outliers that we have found, then this is what the outliers we have found for the first, and then for the second, and then for the third. And this is precisely the people that stand out, as I said. All right? Now, here is, I collaborated with a psychologist that is a really fun guy to talk to. And he gave us this data from, there's the five dimension of personality traits. So basically, the premise is that the way you behave depends on five personality factors, they called it. So now they tested Western educated, intelligent, rich Democrats. So the weird people and subjects, they call them weird for that purpose, they took a bunch of people that fall into that class. That's good. So then they asked them, they provided to them a short questionnaire, something like 44 items. That's what the psychologist designed. And I forgot to say the big five that they believe, extroversion, agreeableness, consciousness, neuroticism, and so on. These are the good things that you want to figure out from social factors. So they asked them to rate with a score 1 to 5 questions like that. I see myself as someone who blah, 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 is talkative, is full of energy, or things like that, right? and then you're trying to do out of all the possible traits that you have, what are the top five traits that you have. This is a critical principal component analysis type of problem. And we use this data, and to test how good we are with real data, this psychologist did not give us the answer because he had independent ways of figuring out which records that we got were outliers, because there were some people that purposefully were scoring everything four or whatever. They were tired. And when we showed to him which subjects stood out as outliers, he was really stunned, because indeed, whatever he could independently validate through whatever inconsistency tricks that they have, we could reveal immediately from our, you know, PCI algorithm with robustness. So the moment you can do these things for batch processing, since we have done a lot of things in signal processing on adaptive algorithms, it's not too difficult to imagine how to make them online. And here is a way to make the last one online. This is a guy who was, his name was, I forgot, Young, in the 90s, put forward an algorithm that is known as PAST algorithm, the PAST algorithm. So this is the counterpart of the PAST algorithm for robust online PCA. So basically what you do, you put the forgetting factor, and then you have a sliding window. And it turns out that you don't need to re-estimate ON. You just estimate the most recent one, the most current one. And if you look at this, this is an angle between subspaces, which quantifies how well you track versus time. And this is the PAST algorithm that cannot catch up outliers, and it thinks that something major happened. And our red is the red curve that does a decent job in tracking. And likewise, reconstruction error for our case is extremely good. Now, let me take a further slant of generalizing these ideas. Machine learning people like a lot to play with kernels. And the whole idea is that if you have an input space that a linear regression model is, or a linear classifier is good, you can apply a nonlinear mapping to another feature space where it is still good. And the linear mapping in a higher dimensional space, which can be infinite dimensional, the linear mapping can be translated to a nonlinear mapping in the original space. Okay? So through a kernel, you take the linear space for which you believe linear models are good, and then you map them to a feature space, and you apply linearity up there. Okay? Not too different from what coding theorists are saying. You increase the dimensionality, right? Redundancy, and then you can do a better job. So for those of you that don't know the kernel trick, it suffices to tell you that we have applied this to do robust clustering. And clustering is something that I suppose most people in this room know. If you have three different clusters, but they are non-linearly separable, like the ones that I show here, so you have three circles, right? And then you cannot separate them linearly. If you apply an appropriate kernel, then you go to another domain, and it turns out that using the eigenvectors of the Laplacian, for those of you that have seen that, you can separate these clusters, okay, linearly. And we have been able to do that. And since I came to NC State, then I should talk about football, not soccer, but we did a simple experiment where we look at the network of football teams, NCAA football teams, and this is how it looks like, the network. And these are the nodes of the network. 2,000 games, if you play it with someone, you get an edge. Okay? This is how they are connected. So we basically wanted to take, given this data, to cluster teams without knowing conferences, right? And surprise, surprise, if you look at the team index versus team index, the we had 115 teams, and we identified all the major conferences, and I guess ACC is right here, right? The Atlantic Coast Conference. All NC State falls here correctly. But what is very, very amazing is that we had identified three outliers. And guess who were the outliers? Navy. Navy is Army. They don't belong to a conference, right? And I think Notre Dame or Notre Dame, yeah. And these were exactly identified as being the outliers relative to the cluster. So that's all I had. And in summary, I presented you some ideas at the crossroads of signal processing, robust estimation, and sparse statistics. And the take-home message is that if you know how to tune sparsity in model residuals, then you can come up with robust learning algorithms. And I looked at choice-based preference management that amounts to either a regression or a classification problem. That's for social data analysis, characterized the features of buyers, very useful for marketing. Then I talked about non-parametric utility estimation. So the first one was on the parametric side, non-parametric side. And then I talked about robust principal component analysis, which is useful for dimensionality reduction, but also kernel-based spectral clustering. I didn't talk about distributed implementations, but we have those as well. So the application domains of my social data analysis pertain to measurement, preference measurements, psychometrics, and personality assessment, but also some engineering things like video surveillance. And we have some things on social and power networks, much more than what I presented. Had I known the things that are happening, at least in Hamid's group, the interesting things that are happening on the social networks, I would have given a networking slam because we have worked on some themes along these lines. But I guess that's all I had, and I will be glad to answer questions on those.
My question is, can you take these outliers and determine early trends with them over a course of time?
Early trends with them, meaning?
So, let's say you're traveling over some terrain, and you're crossing over from desert landscape to a forest or something like that. So you start out, you see one tree here, another tree there, but then all of a sudden you're actually in a forest. You're not in the desert anymore. Can you, at what threshold is an outlier actually not an outlier anymore? It's actually the norm.
Well, in order to answer this question, which is very interesting, and it's also very much related to how do I choose lambda. I didn't say it perhaps very clearly, but if I push lambda to zero, right, then immediately I get like a least squares fit, right? So I'm saying no outlier. If I keep increasing it, I get very many outliers. How do I know which one is an outlier, which is not an outlier? And I cannot do it unless I have additional a priori information. And that can come in two flavors. One, so the point I want to make is that prior info needed to specify lambda. So the percentage of what is an outlier or what is a nominal or an inlier. Actually, inlier is a bad connotation.
You mean you want to define the mixture?
No. But what he's asking is, how do I know what is
prior? What you call prior information? Are you talking about the mixture of your data?
Yes. No. My prior information, two types that are very useful for me, are first, if suppose that I'm talking about the model where I have y equals to x transpose w plus o plus noise. One case is if this nominal noise is known, then I know what's the level, roughly speaking, of what's. So I need to have some clean data at some point in my past life that I can set up my norm for. The other thing is, or percentage of outliers known. Yeah, you tell me 1,000 data, give me the 200 outliers. I don't want to see more, I don't want to see less. I'll tell you most likely which are the ones that you should assess. But without any one of this, I cannot.
So you might have to tweak your parameters as time progresses?
Yes. If I learn, for example, that which data are guaranteed to be nominal, then I can use those to learn sigma n squared well.
So in linear models, the outliers are modeled as random variables with like large variance.
In my case, they're deterministically, you know, modeled.
So you always model it as like large variance?
No. The O's, see, in my framework, like this one, for example, right? This is a scalar thing, right? So let's say J. Okay. Here, my O is deterministic, same as W. This is a fundamental difference from Huber, from the Huber theory. Huber says the following. Huber clumps these two into one and says plus whatever, call it V. J.
That is noise.
He treats that as noise, but he says, I have an epsilon contaminated Huber, right? This is Huber. So he says V now follows, for example, an epsilon normal, zero mean sigma 1 square, plus 1 minus epsilon normal, zero sigma 2 square. And let's say that this sigma 2 is small. And so sigma 1 square is much larger than sigma 2 square, right? So that means that most of the time I get a Gaussian noise, but once in a while I can get another Gaussian noise with huge variance, right? So that's the epsilon contaminated model of Huber. And that's how he goes, and he says that then it turns out that if Huber does this, he will end up with a very specific lambda. His lambda, lambda Huber, is a function of this epsilon and corresponds to a specific lambda for me. So if I take the Huber lambda and I plug it to my cost function, I'll find the Huber result. But I argue that this may not be the optimum way of doing it.
So in your model, the O can be any deterministic?
Anything, anything. The only thing I want to have a handle of how sparse it is. I don't want it to be.
So it's sparse.
Yes.
But how is its variance as compared to like a normal noise?
No, in this context, I don't care. I don't care because, as I said, I don't even need. I can have purely a maximum likelihood framework, right? My O, as I said, I can even live with a. Something like this that Huber cannot leave, cannot solve. For some J in some set, J1, and can be this when J belongs to J2, not intersecting with J1. So for some J indices, I have a nominal, right? Suppose I give you data from a nominal model, and then once in a while I throw a junk. Huber cannot model that problem. I can. I can solve that problem. So I'm just saying Huber can be a special case of what I have. And of course, he has another beautiful thing that he can assert minimax optimality. I can only assert optimality in the least trim squares, which is, of course, very valuable.
So, like in your psychological experiment, what type of outliers do you encounter or do you model?
It's exactly the same. We don't, you see, we don't care where it comes from. We postulate that they are modeled like this, like the additive model I said, right? We postulate something like this. Now, whether in reality this is true or not, I don't know. I cannot claim that.
Can you reformulate this problem? In other words, you take your original data.
Yeah.
You project it onto like a sparse basis, you know, like a wavelet basis or something. And then you reformulate your problem as basically as an estimation of the indicator of the coefficients. In other words, now you're looking for the outliers through their position.
Yeah.
And you do basically thresholding.
Yeah, you can perfectly look at it that way.
Yeah.
But the whole idea that I want to advocate is that in this particular, you know, line of work is that most people have looked at sparsity of the signals of interest. And indeed, many signals of interest can be sparse in the proper domain. Wavelet, Fourier, blah, blah, blah. But what I assert is that there is another dual class of problems. Actually, I can establish the duality rigorously, but dual class of problems where sparsity emerges not in the signal of interest, but in the residuals. And this is extremely valuable when it comes to coming up with robust algorithms. Because we know that we say something is an outlier because it's sparse. If something is present everywhere, then it's not an outlier, it's a nominal thing. So that's the key idea behind this, the connection of sparsity and robustness. Yes?
With that question on the trends, early trends, you know, with my background in adaptive tracking, can this problem be viewed as or extended to adaptive tracking of functions or parameters or whatever, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So
that could be a way to model something like that.
We have actually solved something that was standing as a problem for more than 30 years, although it's more on the practical side. Mm-hmm. But many people have tried to derive robust algorithms for Kalman filters. But the best that they have succeeded to was to do robust Kalman filtering only when outliers emerge in the measurement equation. Through this formulation, we have been able to derive doubly robust Kalman filters, meaning Kalman filters that allow outliers to be present not only in the measurement equation, but also in the state equation. Because pretty much as you projected, and this is not too far from this robust PCA online. This is like RLS basically. Mm-hmm. RLS penalized with an L1 node, recursively squared. And the moment you can do RLS, you can do online tracking of sparse signals or residuals. And you can also do Kalman filtering or things of that nature when the variation is structured, like you have a state space model. Mm-hmm.
There was actually some work in the mid-80s or something by Sanjoy Mitter and
But they have only looked.
Irvishek.
Yes, that's right. It's a very beautiful tutorial they have.
Yeah.
They have a beautiful tutorial on robust Kalman filters, but if you look at those, they can either handle measurement equation or state equation, not, never the two. And the reason is precisely because the whatever model they were putting on the epsilon contaminated in one, they didn't want it to conflict with the other. For us, it is a matter of baptizing two types of outliers, OX and OY. One is for the state and one the other is for the measurement. So then we keep track of both of them. Yeah.
So let me understand if I appreciate something that you said, I may not have understood correctly. If the statistics are known and they're
of
Gaussian,
what statistics?
The statistics of the outliers are known and Gaussian, then you use the Huber statistic. Now, if the statistics would be known but not Gaussian, then you could use, you know, some other method like belief propagation. You're talking about specifically about the case where the statistics of outliers are unknown. All you know is that they're mean.
Yes.
Okay.
One of the papers that we have is universal. There is a universality to this approach, pretty much like least squares. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, least squares are extremely good. You don't need PDF knowledge to solve the least squares problem. Of course, the moment you know that it's unbiased, then you say, oh, it's unbiased. If it's white, then you know it's maximum likelihood. It's blue, best linear. Then if it's Gaussian, becomes maximum likelihood. And though, so you can assert progressively enhanced versions of optimality. But to solve the good old least squares, you don't need distribution. Yeah. That's why I started with a very basic problem that statisticians have defined. Over. Yeah. Yeah, that's okay. So the point is that the point I wanted to make is that least squares, that's why I started from least trimmed squares. That's a very, very interesting problem. If you go on MATLAB at home and try to solve the least trimmed squares, like the least squares is, you look at the cost function, it's a good, beautiful, smooth cost function. Try to say that out of this data, you know, 20% are outliers, and try to plot how the cost would look like when this knowledge is true. Like, it's like a sawtooth type of, very non-convex problem, the least trimmed squares, the NP-hard that I said. So that's how I started, and I established that using the zero norm, you get the coming line, the best thing, the least trimmed squares. And then I started exploring good relaxations of those, and how you can.
So I think, I also try to understand. So these outliers come from outside, right? Like either contaminated by computation errors or
what have you.
Okay, so can your methods deal with like a malicious attack who actually try to manipulate the data while fit the linear model?
Yeah. Actually,
sorry, you took your microphone off.
Yeah. Okay.
Are you done?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're pretty much done. We're almost
yeah.
Gone here.
Yeah, that's a good point. The O, one of the reasons is that the outliers can be actually intentional. And we have a series of papers that are coming up, one in information theory, the other in SP, and the other in the problem that we look at looks like this. Since I have been used here, measure packets, right?
I mean, try to think a little bit. Yes, okay. So suppose you have flows, right? It can be audio, video, you know, data from any origin to any destination pair in your network. So if this RLF is binary 01, which tells you which flow participates in the link IJ, right? You may have anomalies
right on the board.
Wind.
Okay, there you go.
Very good. So, okay, anomaly. Suppose you have someone that sits up at the link and what they call DOS, denial of service attack. So he puts packets there. So this is the routing matrix, binary. This is the traffic matrix, X. This is the anomaly matrix. So you can perceive this one as O, as an outlier, and call it sparse, and then you can use a lot of tricks that we have developed to solve this problem. The nice thing about this is that it is sparse, okay? The challenging part is that it is sparse. This one is sparse, the anomalies. This is unknown, the X. And the claim is, given Y and R, find, the claim is that I can find A. I can identify the anomalies where someone injected what in the line flow. People, Provela and people at Boston have used PCA for that purpose. I think you've heard about those. But using some low rank plus sparsity problems, that's a very fundamental, I don't know whether you guys can appreciate that, but if I like, the claim is very strong. It says that suppose I combine these two, right, R and X into a matrix XR plus R times A. Forget the noise. What I claim here is that if you give me Y, I can, there are, under certain conditions, I can identify both XR and RA. It's a fundamental problem, right? Because I give you 12, the left-hand side, it can be 6 plus 6, 7 plus 5, it can be 3 plus 9. You understand what I'm saying, right? So I can separate the mixture. If I know that this is low rank, okay, and I know that this is sparse. So that's the...
Well, that's very powerful.
Yeah, it is very useful. But just to say yes to your answer, exploiting this sparsity, I can do anomaly detection in IP networks, for example.
All right, let's thank our speaker. You have him.